Very good. Perfect. I think we can start. Today, let me close the door. If you feel disturbed by the noise in the back, you just have to close the window that remained open. Okay. Today, the lecture focuses on the next link, which is Climate Change and Water Cycle. This is the title of the lecture. And there is, as usual, a web page, which I will use, but I will use also the PowerPoint, which you can find for download at the end of the page, as usual. Okay, so let me switch to the PowerPoint now, which is here. Oh, sorry. This is not in presentation mode. In presentation mode, it's here. Okay. Just one second. Let me put this on the top of the screen. And okay. So why climate change and water cycle? Because the water cycle is an essential component of the climate system. And the water cycle is basically the vector that conveys the impact on the socio-economic system, conveys most of the impacts of climate change. So it is essential that we understand the role of the water cycle in the climate system, and it's essential that we understand the dynamics, the changes in variables that are typical of the water cycle. Variables that are typical of the water cycle are precipitation, rainfall, snowfall. It's also related to evaporation, and the water cycle is also related to water resources availability, river flow, floods, droughts. Of course, everything that concerns water is part of the water cycle, and the water cycle in turn is part of the climate system. So this is the reason why we try to understand today numbers, and not just a qualitative description, but numbers related to changes in the water cycle. Changes in the water cycle are also called hydrological change, water change, and rainfall change, flood change. Flood change is a keyword with a lot of entries in Google, drought change, etc. First, let me say that given that the water cycle is an essential component of the climate system, the water cycle is also modeled by climate models. But climate models, they adopt a simplified representation of the water cycle. Why simplified? For the obvious reason that climate models are global models, and they cannot describe in detail each process of the Earth system. And therefore, the water cycle is simplified, is represented in a simplified way. On the other hand, the water cycle is modeled by hydrologists within the science of hydrologists. Hydrology is the science of the water cycle. And hydrologists, usually, they work at local scale, and they use more detailed models. They use a level of representation that is very deep. They try to translate also local features of the water cycle. And therefore, you understand that both sciences, climate science and water science, hydrology, should have a close interaction in the description of the climate system. Actually, today, this interdisciplinary interaction is still limited. It's limited because interdisciplinarity, as we already discussed, is always a problem. But this is a problem that we need to overcome. This is a problem that we need to bypass, because we cannot accept the reality that a difficult dialogue between scientists undermines our capability to better understand what are essential features of the Earth system and better predict these essential features. Let me say that it's not a problem of bad will by persons. The problem is a structural problem. Interdisciplinarity is difficult, not for the lack of will by scientists. It's a structural problem because science is organized in a disciplinary setting, and scientific assessment is organized in a disciplinary setting. Scientific journals are typically disciplinary. And we have only a few journals that are interdisciplinary, and for the fact that they are interdisciplinary, it is difficult to give equality of opportunities to all the fields that concur to interdisciplinarity. It is difficult because it's just a management problem. And but in any case, this is indeed a big problem, and which we have to overcome. So the water cycle. The water cycle is very, it's a very old concept that you know from the primary school. And in its essential structure, you know it perfectly. Water is in the oceans, it evaporates, goes in the atmosphere, it undergoes condensation, and then cloud formation, precipitation, and then in the form of precipitation, water gets over the land, flows in part over the land, and part of the water infiltrates in the underground. And at the end, it goes back to the ocean. And the total amount of water in the Earth system is constant. So in its basic structure, we know the water cycle perfectly since a long time ago, since the primary school. On the other hand, this apparent simplicity is misleading, because there are several components of the water cycle that we don't know. For instance, the very simple reason that they are not observable. And a typical example is groundwater flow. The flow of water that takes place in the underground, we still have a limited capability to model it, because we have a limited understanding, a limited capability to observe it. And so many of these processes, which are playing a relevant role, groundwater processes, are for us still unknown, at least in their geometric description, which means modeling. And therefore, it is only apparently a simple problem. Incorporating a good description, an acceptable description of water cycle in climate models is still a challenge, is still an open problem, not only for computational reasons, but also for the difficulties related to the geometric description of the system, etc. Several problems, lack of data, we have several problems. So this also explains why interdisciplinarity is difficult, because indeed there are problems to solve, there are funds to invest, resources to invest, research funding, and you understand the problem is a bit, it's not easy. I show you other representation of the water cycle. This is another representation which essentially is the same as the previous picture. This one is better emphasizing the role of the ecosystems. The ecosystems play an essential role in the water cycle and an essential role in the climate system. The water cycle is also vital for keeping the equilibrium then of the whole Earth system. So it is indeed necessary that we understand it, that we promote a better representation of water cycle into climate science. Another picture that is extremely interesting, it's more recent, and you can see almost all of it. I'm trying to understand, sorry, if I can also show, okay, still, I don't, you are just missing the title, not more than that, in on the big screen in the room. We don't need to read everything here, of course, but I want to emphasize the concept. This is a picture, a recent picture by the United States Geological Survey, which emphasizes the human impact on the water cycle. Humans impact the water cycle for many reasons. Perhaps the most important one is the use of water resources. Of course, we need water. And in exploiting water resources, we cause an impact on the water cycle. We modify it. In some regions, the water cycle is deeply modified by humans, which are also modifying then climate. This is fine. I mean, we don't have to be concerned by the disturbance, the human impact by itself, but we have to be concerned about sustainability. And if you put together this last consideration that I just made and the previous consideration, which is related to the groundwater that we still don't understand in detail, we still cannot describe in detail. And if you take into account that groundwater is essential as a water resource for humans, you understand that we are using something, we are exploiting a resource without knowing if our exploitation, our use are sustainable. And therefore, this clarifies the importance of the problem. And there are other impacts, human impacts on the water cycle, for instance, due to the release of pollutants. If you think of the sewer systems, they are releasing dirty water even after depuration, after treatment. Water is not so clean when it comes out from a treatment, and it is released in the water bodies. Other impacts are related to agriculture. It's related to water use, of course, but agriculture also impacts the water cycle, not only through the use of water for irrigation, but also by compacting the soil. And soil compaction reduces infiltration, reduces the recharge of groundwater. The same for urbanization. Urbanization increases the surface of the paved areas and therefore reduces the recharge of groundwater. There are several other impacts. You can think of deforestation, you can think of skiing resorts, which are using water for producing artificial snow and are causing deforestation. There are a lot of impacts. As I said, we don't have to be concerned by the impact by itself, but rather of its sustainability from any possible perspective. Sustainability also in terms of perturbation of the landscape, which is important. Okay, so let's try to understand today in what way climate change impacts variables of the Earth system, state variables of the Earth system that are related to water. And I will start with temperature. Temperature is something that we already know. We already discussed about temperature, but then we will discuss of changes in precipitation, changes in floods, changes in droughts, changes in sea level. And I would say that's it for today, okay? What I'm saying today is basically a narrative, but I will give you some orders of magnitude. Focus your attention on the orders of magnitude first, because they are important. If you want to get a scientific perspective of a process of Earth system, you first have, I already said this to you, you first have to get the perception of the order of magnitude. A quantitative description of a process, a scientific description, starts from the order of magnitude. A second reason to focus on the orders of magnitude is that probably is the only question that you may find on the quiz, your final quiz related to today's lecture. Because today is essentially a narrative, so don't be concerned by the amount of information that I'm delivering in terms of your exam, but try to get the essence of this information in order to build your scientific background related to climate change. Okay, so let's try to start if I can. Perfect. So first of all, let's remember the definition of climate change, in order to understand what we are talking about, to refresh what we are talking about. So climate change can be defined as a long-term change in the statistical distribution of weather variables. Statistical distribution. Beware of the difference between weather and climate. An important thing is that today, when we say climate change, we implicitly assume that is human-caused. Try to keep this in mind, because actually climate change may be also interpreted in a broader way, meaning any change in climate, no matter if it's human-induced or not. But actually, today, when we say climate change, the usual perception by the media and by the public is related to the human impact on it. A previous term, climatic change, which was introduced by the World Meteorological Organization in the 60s, is no more used, essentially. So we use climate change. In Italian, we say cambiamento climatico. Just be aware that the other forms of possible climate change, those that are not caused by humans, generally go under the umbrella of the term natural variability. So you today, when you listen to the media or look at the scientific papers, you usually see the two terms, climate change and natural variability. And the difference is that one is human induced and the other is natural. Actually, I don't think that natural variability is a good term for the change that is not human induced, because variability implicitly admits that something is going back and forth, up and down, but it is in the long term stationary, so not changing in the long term. Actually, there are some natural induced changes of climate that are permanent. Think of a meteorite that may hit the globe and change the inclination of the Earth axis. This would induce a permanent change. And also, if you think of changes in the solar activity, changes in the solar activity may be temporary, but may be also permanent. So I think it is a bit misleading to say natural variability as opposed to climate change for the human-induced part of it. But it's important that we understand each other, okay? And it's important then that we understand the information that we get. So why climate change, human-induced climate change? For the greenhouse effect, as we know. We already mentioned this. And also the greenhouse effect is important that you know that is fully natural to some extent. Without the greenhouse effect, the temperature, the average temperature of Earth would be something like minus 18 Celsius. Actually, as you know, because we talked about it, it's around 14 Celsius. So there is a big contribution in terms of warming of the, let's call it, natural greenhouse effect. It's due to the fact that in the atmosphere we have gases that are reflecting back to the Earth part of the heat that is emitted by the Earth's surface. So this heat is trapped into the atmosphere. Of course, there is a human contribution to it. If humans increase the emissions of CO2, if humans have an impact on the carbon cycle, then there is an increase of the greenhouse effect. And this is what we think occurred during the last 150 years with an acceleration in the past 30 years. And temperature, as I said already to you, it's an hard fact. Nobody is neglecting that the global temperature is increasing, that we are in a warming period. In fact, when we talk about the climate change period, when we talk about global warming, we implicitly refer to the last 30 years since 1990. This is what by tradition is defined the global warming period. Even if it started before than that, but in the last 30 years, it was accelerated, okay? And now, as I said, its temperature is an evidence. The big question is, what about other climate variables? What about precipitation? Which is relevant, because precipitation, as I said, is regulating water resources, is impacting floods, is impacting droughts, okay? So you already saw this picture. It's it's showing the amount of global warming from 1950 to 2013. And if you look at the NASA website, for sure there is a picture that is updated. What is important to be fully aware of is that the spatial distribution of warming is not homogeneous. So there are hotspots, in particular in the northern hemisphere. This is important because it implies that there will be hotspots also in the changes in precipitation, in the changes in the other relevant variables. Even the sea level rise is not homogeneous. The sea level is not everywhere at the same level. There are local changes which are induced by tides, and also to the fact that there is a continuous flow of water into the ocean, and then to originate this flow may originate some disparities in sea level rise. Okay, so again on temperature, you see what is the order of magnitude of the increase. We already discussed it. Okay, after the Industrial Revolution, we are talking about from 1 to 1.3, 1.4 degrees of warming. Beware of this order of magnitude. What you see here is a figure that is not updated, is not up to date. It's I think it's up to 2016. If you click here, just one second, yes. If you click here, we already saw this picture. You get a progress of the monthly data of temperature. It's coming. And starting from, let's see if I can. Okay, here it is. I was successful. So this is a picture that is a little bit different because it's showing monthly data, but you see the order of magnitude is more or less the same. We are about plus one now, a little bit lower than plus one, but we started from minus 0.3. So you see that the order of magnitude is about 1.3. Here you can see that, but we already discussed this, that in the past, I would say 4 or 5 years, the situation fortunately is quite stable, but you know, it was stable also between here, between 2002-03 and 2013-14. For 10 years, we didn't have a significant increase. This time span here is called the time span of the hiatus in global warming. But then we had a sharp increase. And now again, it seems stabilization, but you know, it is, we cannot be of course reassured that it will remain stable for a long time. Let me go back to the presentation. Now, what about a picture, a longer picture? Here, what you can see, in the past, the previous two figures were based on observations. Here, it's based on proxy data. And in particular, this reconstruction of temperature changes, it's derived from concentration of isotopes, oxygen isotopes. They are markers which we can find in the ice cores in the sediments of lakes. These are proxy data that we use to reconstruct the past climate. And this allows us to go back, you see here, several hundred millions of years, 500 millions of years from today. So one important thing that I already mentioned to you, but I want to stress it again, is that we are currently in the quaternary glaciation. This is something that people actually don't know. So we are in a cold period of the history of the Earth. You see on the far right, cold. Actually, people usually don't know that because we are told that the glaciation finished about, the last glaciation finished about 11,000 years ago. Actually, what finished about 11,000 years ago was a minimum in the glaciation. And the past 11,000 years have been characterized, we will see a zoom, by an increase in temperature. But still we are in a minimum of temperature, as you can see from this figure. From this figure, you can see the big glaciations, which at their during their period exhibited up and downs of temperature, and these up and downs are called intraglacial periods. And these up and downs are not visible here because here you see two lines, the blue one and the black one. The blue one and the black one are moving averages. So they are averages, they show the average of temperature computed in the long term. Long term means several millions of years. So the variations within this window are averaged out. And as I said, the black line is using a window on which to compute the average that is longer with respect to the blue one. So the black one looks a smooth version of the blue one. And the reason is that the window is longer, but we are talking of windows of about 20 millions of years. So you don't see at the extreme right of the graph, the current increasing temperature because it is smoothed out. So the last point is the average temperature of the past 20 millions of years. The recent increase of the last 30 years is averaged out. And also there is to say one more thing. These glaciations determined changes in temperature from the minimum and the magnitude of tens of degrees, while in the past 150 years, we are talking of an increase of 1 degree. So it wouldn't be visible in this graph. This graph puts in evidence that this so-called natural variability of climate, as we know, during glaciation caused shifts in temperature that are extremely relevant. As I said, tens of degrees. And what is the reason of the glaciations? What is the reason of these changes in temperature? We don't know. You know that there are hypotheses, there are possible explanations, which range from changes in solar activity, changes caused by volcanic eruptions, changes caused by changes in the inclination of the Earth axis, maybe after the impact of asteroids. So there are several explanations that have been put forward, but actually we don't have the final answer. The important thing to know is that there is for sure a natural variability of climate, which is extended over time scales of millions of years, which is superimposed to the human-induced changes. But keep in mind the time scale. Here we are talking about fluctuations, which are much higher than the global warming, but take place in millions of years. Look at the time scale here from zero to the second glaciation, 250 millions of years. While global warming is, of course, acting on a very local time scale. This is important to be kept in mind. But let's make a zoom now, a progressive zoom, starting from this time scale, very expanded, to smaller time scale. Now, let me make a zoom at the very far right of this graph by showing to you a picture of changes in temperature, global temperature, in the past about 500,000 years. So here it's 500 million years. Now let's look at 500,000. Temperature is the graph on the top, and then there is carbon dioxide in the middle and dust concentration at the bottom. And these are all computed, estimated, reconstructed through ice cores. So here you can see the raising temperature of the past about 11,000-12,000 years. We will see another zoom on the right to focus on this increasing temperature. But please look at the time scale, at the scale of the temperature changes. In the past, you see, look at the right of the graph, in the past 11,000-15,000 years, we went from -8, zero is the current average temperature of the Earth. We went from -8 to zero. So about 8 degrees after, let's say, the last minimum of the current glaciation. 8 degrees means, as we will see, a change in sea level of about 120 meters. What's interesting here is the comparison between the graph on the top and the graph in the middle, which shows that the concentration of CO2 is strictly correlated to temperature. It is a relevant scientific question to determine who came first, who comes first. It's a chicken and egg question, because of course there is not a strict correspondence, so you cannot really say if it is temperature governing CO2 or the other way around. And now, this is a relevant question, of course. It's a relevant question, even if, let me say, it's relevant, but not so much, because it's clear, we know that there is for sure a feedback of the ocean to the increase of temperature. The ocean tends to release more CO2. So it is an evidence, it is something that we know. So I don't think it is so relevant to understand in detail who comes first, because it may happen that in certain periods CO2 came first, and then in other periods the reason of the natural changes in temperature was solar activity, and then CO2 came later. So it is quite understandable that there might be some changes in that. So given that we have a physical support to the fact that for sure, if humans increase the CO2 emissions, there might be a corresponding increase of temperature. I don't think it is really so worthy dedicating a lot of resources on solving a question which I'm not sure it has an answer. But in any case, it's interesting, and we need to be fully aware that they are related by cause and effect, by perturbation and feedback. Not the same can be said for dust concentration. Dust is, yes, in some cases looks related to the increase in temperature or to decreases in temperature. What we would expect actually is that we have a decrease of temperature for increasing dust concentration. And we see that more or less we can see this behavior, but not always. Of course, increasing dust concentration means that there is an increase of the screen against preventing solar energy reaching the Earth's surface. And this is why we expect a direct effect on that. Okay. Let's zoom even more. And this is a zoom in the past 2000 years. I think we already discussed the variability during this time span. We already discussed the medieval warm period, for which we have also some oral traditions that report to us that especially over the Alps in the Middle Age, the temperature around the year 1000 was higher than the temperature today. We are not sure of what happened in other regions, because we have these oral traditions that refer to Europe only. And then we already discussed the Little Ice Age. What is important to say is that our historical information suggests that during the warm periods, we had an optimum of socioeconomic setting, while during the cold periods, we experienced huge problems in terms of floods, in terms of agricultural productivity. So this is what the history suggests. On the other hand, it's clear that the setting was completely different, and therefore we cannot say that we cannot make a direct comparison with today and conclude that the warming, the recent global warming, has brought benefits or will bring benefits. It's a completely different story. But for the ancient times, what we know is that during the warm periods, we experienced prosperity. During the cold periods, we experienced famine and lack of food. As I said, today the setting is different. Today it's not only agriculture providing the means to sustain our development, and therefore the situation is different. And today what is really different is the presence of a global network of food import-export, which in a way makes the dependence on local conditions a little bit lower. We are less dependent on local conditions today, even if you know that in terms of financial resources that are needed to ensure this connectivity, there might be some problems. Okay, now, what I want to say with this slide is that we have also the problem of understanding what the future will look like. And therefore, we have also the problem of making predictions. So far, we analyze data. So this allows me to introduce an important information for you. When you get information on climate change, make sure you understand how the information is generated. It's data analysis or it's a model prediction, because there are these two ways to get information about the state of the climate system. We may get observation of the state, but getting observations is complicated. And if we go back in the past, maybe impossible. Okay, we can use ice cores, etc., but these are very specific information. So we can use observation, or we can use models to reconstruct, to predict the state of the system. Both these sources of information are essential. They are complementary. Models allow us to get information everywhere. On the other hand, the information that comes from data is, in terms of uncertainty, probably more consistent. Probably, I say probably because it always depends on how the data were collected. But beware of this difference. You get information like the frequency of floods increased, and ask this question: how was this information derived? Through models or through data? You may have heard something like, the frequency of droughts is increasing. This information necessarily doesn't come from data. It can only come from models, because data don't support this conclusion. So beware of the difference, which doesn't mean that models are less reliable than observations. It doesn't mean that. It means that information has to be interpreted in a different way. Okay. Good. This is what is written in this slide. When we use data, we can call it inductive approach, inductive information. When you use models, we can call it deductive information, deductive approach. We know that how the climate models work because we already had a lecture, so we don't spend time on this slide. When you read my web pages, when you study, of course, you may find some duplication of material because they have been prepared in different times and for different purposes during time. So just try to distill out a unique sample of information, of course. The overlaps are not very extended. I just want to make you aware that, especially in this lecture, which is very general, very extended, you may find some duplication. Now let's go to precipitation. The title here is precipitation. I already showed to you this image. It's an animation. It shows the distribution over the globe of precipitation in the different months. We use precipitation to mean both rainfall and snowmelt. Otherwise we say rainfall or we say, sorry, not snowmelt, snowfall. So precipitation means both of them. It's the sum of rainfall plus snowfall. Otherwise, if you want to mean rainfall, we say rainfall. If you want to mean snowfall, we say snowfall. Okay, this is precipitation. So beware of the order of magnitude, which I already pointed to your attention. The max of precipitation, annual precipitation over the globe is about 2,500 millimeters. Two meters and a half. You see that here the slide mentions an interesting example of how our knowledge of the water cycle is still limited. You would expect under global warming that evaporation increases. Actually, if you analyze the pan evaporation data, pan evaporation means evaporation from liquid surfaces. So you put a tank outside and you measure the decrease in the volume of water in one day, for instance. This data on pan evaporation show that at the global level, after global warming, evaporation decreased. So what is the explanation? Actually, we don't really know, but there is an explanation which is not explained here. It is not explained here, which is related to the distribution of wind velocity. Evaporation is strongly influenced by temperature, wind, and other variables, but temperature and wind are the most important. Wind, why? Because if after evaporation the local atmosphere gets saturated, you don't have evaporation anymore. If after evaporation wind brings fresh air, then evaporation increases. Of course, when we wash our clothes and we put them outside to dry, we know that they dry faster if there is wind. With the same temperature, if you have some wind, they dry much faster. This is the reason. So this could be a possible explanation, which is not listed here. Another explanation may be that if you put an evaporimeter outside, an evaporimeter is the instrument to measure pan evaporation, and you have the air that is already saturated by increased evaporation from the surroundings, then you may notice decrease in the evaporation from the vaporimeter, which is governed by the fact that the atmosphere is already saturated, not by the fact that you have a actual decrease of evaporation potential. This is a possible explanation. Another possible explanation is there is cloud formation after evaporation, which act as a screen against solar irradiance. And therefore, of course, more evaporation, higher temperature, more evaporation, more clouds, decrease of evaporation. This is a nice example of the capability of the Earth system to compensate with a positive feedback, which indeed is possible. It is possible. Why it's important to speak about evaporation? It's important because somewhere in these slides, if not yet here, maybe in the next one, no, let's say, but in any case, a slide we can, mentioning that with an increase of the temperature of the atmosphere, we have an increase in the water retention potential of the atmosphere at saturation. In a gas, the capability of the gas to absorb water vapor increases with temperature. So the saturation level increases with temperature. So after global warming, you expect more water in the atmosphere. There is an equation, very famous physical equation, the Clausius-Clapeyron equation, that says that at saturation, the capacity of the atmosphere to retain water increases 7% per each degree of warming. So it means that after global warming, that increased our temperature of 1 degree, we have an atmosphere that at saturation retains 7% more of water, which means a potential for violent storms. There is more water in the atmosphere, we expect more rain. And given that the temperature is higher, we expect more rainfall, what is called convective rainfall, the thunderstorms. Okay. But on the other hand, we have to be fully aware, pay attention to what I'm saying, that the potential to retain water doesn't automatically imply that water is actually retained. If there is enough evaporation, then the atmosphere goes to saturation. If evaporation is limited at the ground, then the fact that you have an increase in the potential to take water from the atmosphere doesn't imply an increase in the actual, in the real content. So this explains why climate scientists and hydrologists working on evaporation. They wanted to prove whether the water content in the atmosphere is actually increased or not. And, there is no final conclusion. The final conclusion, we look at it by analyzing rain. Is it true that we get more rainfall? Is it true that we get more thunderstorms? This is what we are trying to understand. And the question, as we will see with a series of graphs, is still to some extent open. Okay, let's move forward. This is the annual precipitation in Bologna. This is a first attempt. I already showed you this picture. A first attempt to understand if something has changed. And Bologna is a good example because it's a very long series. Actually, what we can see here is that It looks like the only change that we can notice is a decrease of the gray zones, which are the long droughts. The long droughts seem to be decreased. Maybe that is due to the fact that there is more water in the atmosphere. Maybe, but in this case, we wouldn't understand why we are concerned by increase of droughts under global warming. Okay, but this is a first, let's say, food for thought. And if you take other of these graphs, other examples like this one, you will see that at the global level, average rainfall, so the rainfall as usual, the annual rainfall, is not changed much. So it means that in terms of droughts, you know, it's a puzzle. It's a puzzle. Okay, again, this is a bit more complicated to understand, but the concept is very easy. What is this? It's a study that I co-authored. It got a lot of citations, but I think the conclusions are not very helpful, actually. And I tell you, this study took into account daily rainfall. So Bologna, I go back just one second, this is annual rainfall. Okay, this study considered daily rainfall because we wanted to focus on the short time scale, because these violent thunderstorms, they don't have an effect in the total rainfall of 1 year. They have an effect on the rainfall of 1 day of very short time scale. And let me say that the very violent thunderstorms, they last for a few minutes only. So it is really difficult to get observation of this data. At the daily time scale, we still have a lot of data. And you see the spatial distribution. Look at the static picture for now of the cells. They are changing color. Look at the static picture. It's the spatial distribution of the observation that we have collected. And we were able to put together about 68,000 of stations with a length of 50 years. The time span here of the analysis is from 1960 to 2010. What we wanted to see is if the frequency and intensity of high rainfall, so frequency and intensity of thunderstorm, have changed. And what we found, let's look on the left and let's look on the top graph, which is more easily understandable. It's a progress along time of the frequency of high rainfall. And you see that it's increasing. But if you look at the percentage, let's look at the last line. It's too fast, but it goes the number of extreme increased from 0.9 with respect to the current average to the global average to 0.9 to 105, more or less. So there is an increase of about 12% during the observation period of the frequency of high rainfall. What does it mean? It means that if an event occurred in the past once a year, now it occurs about 1.12 in a year. It's not really a big change. It doesn't help very much. It doesn't justify the observed increase in flood frequency. And what here you see the distribution on the right over the whole globe. So it's a replicate of the graph that you find on the left. And the distribution in the northern hemisphere, in the left part of the northern hemisphere and the right part of the northern hemisphere. There are not big changes actually, but in the northern hemisphere, temperature is increased more and also the frequency of these extremes has increased. What about intensity? Intensity didn't change much, just like 4% at the global level. So even the analysis of the daily rainfall doesn't really support doesn't provide a consistent support to the attribution of the increase in flood frequency to an increase in rainfall frequency and intensity. But there is a but, and this is why I say that it is not really helpful. We already knew from other studies that in terms of annual rainfall, in terms of rainfall over the long term, as I said, there are no significant changes. Our perception is that changes are in the short time scale. Daily time scale is not short enough because the floods that originated the major impact in Italy, but also in Europe recently, are floods originated by rainfall that last for a few minutes only. So over the daily rainfall, you don't see a big issue. We need the data at the hourly time scale, and these are not easily available, but there are several studies highlighting that in some regions of the world, indeed, they found an increase in intensity of hourly rainfall ranging from 6 Clausius Clapeyron, 6% is Clausius Clapeyron, to 18-20% in the hotspots. 18-20% is a significant increase. 6% is not really providing enough support. So if we had to rely on this data, we would say probably floods are originated more by land use change than climate change. But as I said, there is still the question mark of the very short months of the flood that develop in much less than one day, like the flood in the Marche region or developed in a few hours. So we need to better inspect in that direction. On the other hand, models tell us that there is a significant increase. Even after 1 degree increase of temperature, models, basing on very simplified schemes, they say that they provide support to this assumption, but depending on the local conditions. And therefore, integration of the information is extremely important. Now let's turn to sea level rise. Sea level rise is important. We know from the media that is a matter of concern after warming, after global warming. It's a matter of concern for the safety of coastal regions, for flood, for coastal flooding is a matter of concern. And again, let's start from a picture, a couple of pictures showing what happened during the increase of temperature that occurred starting from about 15,000 years ago and terminated about 8,000 years ago. There was, as we remember from the graph that I showed to you previously, an increase in temperature of about 8 degrees, which implied an increase in sea level of about 120 meters. So let's keep this in mind. This was fully natural, or let's say, of course, was not human induced, okay? And when we say natural, we mean normally everything is not related to humans, okay? Good. Now let's focus. There is another picture here, which is similar. The picture on the top of the screen, it is similar. In the bottom of the screen, you see a map of the Earth with highlighted in red the pixel that would be flooded by a sea level rise of 6 meters. 6 meters. Of course, they are coastal regions. And you don't have to be misled by the limited extension. Coastal regions are extremely important. They occupy about, I don't remember the number, but few percent, I think less than 10% of the global extension of the lands, but in coastal region live about 40% of the human population. So don't be misled by the limited extension of the red pixels, because actually, if we depicted over this picture the percentage of people that would be flooded, it's really huge, really huge. What is a little bit misleading here is the 6 meters of sea level rise, because actually it is not something that even models are expecting for now. And so let's now talk about recent from observations sea level rise. Let me anticipate that sea level can be measured with two measuring instruments, two gauges. One is direct measurements that is taken with direct observations. And these direct observations allow us to cover a quite extended period in the past, but they are spot measurements. And then there is satellite measurements. Satellite measurements started only in around 1990. So we have only 30 years, but they cover the global warming period. And satellite measurements provide a much more distributed picture, because for any pixel of the image taken by the satellite, we have a measurement. Okay, let's have a look at the... Let me give you an example of an ocean map taken by a satellite. I need to go to another lecture of another course. I'm also teaching harbor engineering and coastal engineering. So let's take my lectures of coastal engineering and let's... I think here there is, these are direct measurements. And in this case, you see a disturbance. This sea lion is a bit disturbing. And this is another direct measurement of sea level. And let's now go here. This is a topography of the ocean, which is taken from satellite measurements. And you see that the elevation is changing, is not constant. It also depends on the wind, the speed, tides. But this is indeed a source of information that it's very, very relevant. Okay. Let me go back here. Good. Now, back to the presentation. Just one second. Here. So, the recent zoom. What is important here, once again, is the order of magnitude. First of all, here you see, look on the text on the left and the quote, the water level may have dropped by 2 meters or more between 2000 and 500 before Christ. What does seem certain is that there was a tendency for world sea level to rise progressively during the time of the Roman Empire, finally reaching a high stand around 400 after Domine, comparable with or slightly above the present. And then you see on the right what the measurements say. Again, look at the order of magnitude, which is about 15 to 20 centimeters of sea level rise between 1880 and 2000. And this sea level rise is quite steady quite steady from, let's say, 1900 to today, according to measurements, look at the black line. But satellite measurements, as we will see during the global warming period, the red line is satellites, show that there is a rate of increase that is higher in the last 30 years than the previous period, not much higher. So this picture, you know, gives an interpretation that may be like a bit strange, because we would expect in the past 30 years a sharp increase. There was an increase in temperature, and therefore we may expect a corresponding increase in sea level rise. Keep in mind that the sea level rise is due to two reasons after warming: thermal expansion of water and ice melting. So what our intuition may suggest is that there might be some delay, because the temperature of the ocean is increasing with delay with respect to the temperature of the atmosphere. So maybe that the effect of global warming in terms of sea level rise is still to come. This is possible. Actually, this is what also models suggest. On the other hand, look at the order of magnitude, and which is 20 centimeters, from 15 to 20 centimeters, which it's not comparable to the 6 meters that were used by NASA to reconstruct the flood map. And also keep in mind the order of magnitude, because we will see now the model predictions and what they say. Okay. So let's, one thing. This quote is taken by a monograph that was written by Judith Carey. Judith Carey, I think it is relevant information for you, because she has a website, a blog, that is providing a lot of information on climate. I would say that she is considered a climate skeptic, but I must say that I found a lot of information that was very useful on her website, because it's related to data analysis. So you know that you may be referring to a climate skeptic, but on the other hand, she has a very good reputation. A very good reputation, and I must say that the information that she provides is really so. For instance, this monograph on sea level rise was something that was very useful for me to get information on the state of this important variable, which is sea level, and information which is backed up by sources of information, sources of data. It is useful. And this is to emphasize what I'm saying, emphasizes the need that we need to get reliable information, no matter what is the interpretation that is provided by this information. The interpretation is something that we can re-elaborate, but it is important that we get information from several sources if we want to get a scientific perspective. So don't reject climate skepticism by definition. In climate skepticism, there might be some useful information. And then, of course, the interpretation is to be taken depending also on the purpose of your possible application, on your target. Okay. Now, this is instead a quote from the IPCC, which is not agreeing in terms of interpretation with very often Judith Carey doesn't agree with the IPCC. And they say, it is very likely, the IPCC always speaks in these terms, so doesn't say it is certain, because very often they talk about deductive information models, so they cannot say we are certain that. So it is very likely that the mean rate of global average sea level rise was 1.7 with a range of variability millimeters per year between 1901 and 2010, and 3.2 between 1993 and 2010. It is likely that similar high rates of sea level rise occurred between 1920 and 1950. So we observe cyclical behaviors, which we cannot really explain and are not directly related to global warming. And here you see the picture from the IPCC. I think this is taken, it is a picture by NASA, but I think it is also taken by the IPCC report. Okay. Now, keep in mind that sea level rise is also related to other atmospheric processes like El Nino. El Nino also causes has an impact on sea level. So this periodicity of the sea level may be also related to the state of the atmosphere, and in particular to El Nino. El Nino, as we will see later on, it's a temperature difference between the two extremes of the Pacific Oceans, the west one and the east one. And therefore, it's clear that if you have a difference in temperature in the ocean, there is also a difference for thermal expansion of sea level. And in fact, when we look at the satellites, we see these differences, these changes in topography. And here we go to predictions for the future that are elaborated through climate models. I think this is another interesting piece of information. This is taken by the IPCC Assessment Report 5. What you see is predictions of temperature change and sea level rise. And this prediction refers to two periods and four emission scenarios. Mm-hmm. Emission scenarios are something that you already know. So the two periods are around 2050, and the other one is ending in 2100. The scenarios, if you remember, go from the more optimistic one, which is RCP 2.6, which corresponds to a decrease of CO2 concentration in the atmosphere with respect to the current level, which means that also the warming should decrease into the future with respect to the current level. And the last one, RCP 8.5, is the so-called business as usual, which corresponds to no action to reduce CO2 emission, and the CO2 emissions from human activities would steadily increase with the same rate, with the same pace they increased in the past 30 years. Let's say that probably RCP 2.6 is not obtainable. But there is also a growing consensus that also RCP 0.5 is excessively pessimistic. On the other hand, let's look at the worst predictions given by RCP 0.5. And keep in mind that the changes that you see there, they are total changes with respect to the pre-industrial period. So they include already the warming that we have already observed. So, in terms of temperature, RCP 0.5 would correspond to an increase of 2 degrees, which is well beyond the target of the Paris Agreement by 2050. Currently, we are at 1.3, so it means 0.7 more in the remaining, 20 years. 3.7 by 2100 degrees of temperature. So let's look at the last line here. It's sea level rise. It's let's look at the extreme, at the upper extreme of the likely range. It's about 38 centimeters by 2050, which means twice the sea level rise that we already observed from the pre-industrial period. And then we get 82 centimeters by 2100. This is the more pessimistic number that we can get from models, which on the one end, it's huge. On the other end, it's not comparable with the 6 meters that NASA adopted in order to make their visualization. But there is to say that these are model predictions, and there are some models which are excluded by the likely range, which predict a greater increase. In fact, models work on the basis of our current knowledge, and they don't take into account something that probably already occurred in the past history of our planet, which is a sudden melting of the ice caps. So we are trying to understand whether in the other cases in which the ice cap melted down, the melting was gradual, slow, and in a way proportional to the increase of temperature, or if there was a sudden melting originated by a tipping point that was crossed. What could be the physical explanation of such sudden outbursts, sudden glacial floods? The explanation may be the fact that we recently discovered that beneath the ice caps, there are huge lakes of liquid water which are encapsulated into the ice. And the reason why this water remains in the liquid phase is the high pressure originated by the ice that is standing above. There is a lot of research activities, a lot of monitoring ongoing to get more information on these liquid volumes of water, which look huge, that are trapped into the ice caps. And why there is interest? Because this is water that is already liquid. So a reduction of the thickness of the ice cap may cause a sudden break of this ice contour, and a sudden release of what are called subglacial floods. Within a research project that is ongoing, some people are trying to take videos 24 hours a day, because they want, they are trying to get a film, get a recording, a video of a lake, of a subglacial flood. Precisely for the very reason that we want to understand some more. So, of course, this is something that wouldn't appear, this release of liquid water wouldn't appear for all the lakes at the same time, but it is a reason that may accelerate the melting of the ice caps. And this is why there are some climate scientists that think that these numbers that you see on the screen may be excessively precautionary. And this is why sometimes we talk about coastal flooding, and we talk about events that may imply the sudden droning of islands. Furthermore, before we make the break, let me emphasize that you may think that an increase of 80 centimeters is not really dangerous. Okay, this is true for Italy. In Italy, usually we have a slope of the coastal areas that is significant. We don't have just in front of the sea very flat areas. In the Netherlands, you know that they have half of the country, I think, that is below sea level. In Italy, we don't have similar situations. The only, probably the only exception is Venice, where indeed 80 centimeters in Venice would mean a lot, because if you look at the normal sea level in Venice and you add 80 centimeters, it would mean a lot. But in other countries, in very flat areas, 80 centimeters is an important number in terms of flooding. Furthermore, I want to emphasize the impact on saltwater intrusion, which is a big concern in coastal areas. So in coastal areas, especially in the flat coastal areas, in the coastal areas that form the, for the deposition of alluvial sediments, the soil has a huge permeability. And therefore, the salt water can intrude into the land. And the opposition, the contrast to the intrusion of salt water is given by the groundwater flow, the groundwater freshwater flow, which is opposing the coastal intrusion. But the theory suggests that in this confrontation of waters, if you increase the level of salt water, which is heavier than fresh water, it is heavier, of a few centimeters only, you get, in terms of saltwater intrusion, a huge impact. And why it's saltwater intrusion concerning? Because if you get a retreat of fresh water towards the land, it means that you cannot use groundwater resources in the coastal areas, which is a big issue. It is a big issue. So in terms of impact, we don't have to think only about flooding of coastal areas. We have to think of saltwater intrusion. Furthermore, keep into account that we are talking here about mean sea level. We have no clue of how the extremes, maximum height of waves during storms would be impacted. Of course, intuition suggests that if you have an average increase of 80 centimeters, the extreme increase should be higher. And this is an open question. So this is why sometimes people talk about flooding. Okay, the message is focus on the orders of magnitude, because this is what you need, what you first need. Okay. It's time of the break. Do you have any question, any request for clarification? You are too shy. Okay, let's reconvene in 15 minutes. Okay. Let me close the door. Now, as I anticipated, we are making now a focus on floods and droughts. And what we can see here, it's just a second, here it is. What we are seeing here is, okay, first, on the left, you see a picture that I took during the last relevant flood event of the Po River in 2000. It was 23 years ago. After this flood in the Po River, which was a flood that didn't overtop the levees, and it was a flood that was anyway contained within the levees, the main levees of the Po River. After this flood, we didn't experience in big rivers in Italy huge floods. And what you see on the right is a graph showing the max annual maximum peak flow along the Po River from 1920 to 2009. The picture didn't change much in the past 13 years. I have to update it, but there were, as I said, no relevant floods after 2000. You see the peak of 2000 is the last peak that you see. Actually, to be more rigorous, I should say that this is the annual maximum of daily discharge, annual maximum of mean daily discharge, which is not corresponding to the annual maximum peak flow. It is a little bit lower than that, but it is strictly related. You see a regression line that is moving. It is computed on a moving window, which is 50 years long, which means that for any sub window of 50 years, we computed here the regression line. The regression line is painted in blue when there is an increasing trend, and painted in red when there is a decreasing trend. So the regression line, which is computed over a time window that is fairly long, 50 years, it's a long time for a river flow trend estimation. It shows that indeed there is some variability, but essentially you don't see big changes here. So this confirms through an inductive approach and for the Po River only, what I said at the beginning, that for large scale floods means floods over important rivers, big rivers. For large scale floods, we don't really see here in the case of the Po River a significant change. Now, let me give the results here of a study that was recently performed by using a European database. This kind of analysis, international analysis, was not possible up to about 10 years ago, because it was only after the pressure for data sharing that we could put together this important database. It is including something like 5,000 river flow gauging stations, river flow records, 5,000. It's relevant. It was put together after this pressure for data sharing. And this allowed to perform this international continent-wide analysis. And what you see in the figure actually is a synthesis of the results of several studies computed over these databases. And the figure shows with the narrow up the regions where the frequency of floods is increasing, and with the arrow down the regions where it is decreasing. What you can see here is that in some regions of Europe, and in particular the north of Europe, floods are increasing, in particular in the UK. And in the south of Europe, Italy is not yet covered here because it's a picture that didn't include some recent results. In the south of Europe, we see a decrease in flood frequency. It is important to say that these data refer to medium to large scale floods. So they don't include the small floods, which are our main reason of concern, at least in Italy, during the past 20 years. What is the possible explanation for this disomogeneous distribution, not homogeneous distribution of trends? A possible explanation is a shift in the path of the big perturbations, those perturbations that are bringing extreme rainfall to the north, and in particular over Great Britain and over the Alpine region, over the Alpine region where, on the other end, there is also a change in seasonality that has been detected. I will talk about changes in seasonality in with the next slide. So what looks like here is that there is this distribution of changes, and the conclusion is that it is extremely important to analyze the local context, because the distribution of climate change is not homogeneous. This is a confirmation also for floods. Let's say that now let's talk about seasonality. The figure is the same. I don't have here the figure of seasonality because it is a bit, it's not easy to interpret. It's not easy to understand it. So I prefer to keep showing the picture on the distribution of flood peaks, of the trends of flood peaks. So what happened with seasonality? The seasonality of floods changed, particularly where there is a significant contribution to flood of snow melt and ice melting. After global warming, there is an anticipation of snow melt, an anticipation of ice melting, which causes the timing of floods to be shifted of an average period of 5 to 6 weeks. And you may think that this is not concerning. What's the problem if a flood that previously occurred in June and now occurs the mid of April? Actually, this is a problem. It is a problem because if you have snowmelt in June, it is unlikely that it is superimposed to extreme rainfall in our climate. If you have snowmelt in April, you know that April is known to be a month where it rains a lot, usually. Of course, climate is changing, seasonality is changing, but if you look at the mean precipitation, there is still a persistence, a pattern in mean precipitation. If the pattern of precipitation is superimposed over the pattern of snowmelt, this is a problem. Actually, even a shift in time of 6 weeks may be a problem. And this change in seasonality is clear. It's clear with the data. It's something that is really unequivocal. And we will see that it's also important for droughts. So basically, try to focus on those that are the results that are subjected to less uncertainty. So changes in seasonality, also changes in flood frequency, but with a disomogeneous distribution, okay? And the changes in seasonality where snowmelt is important. snowmelt or ice melting. Now, let's talk about droughts. Here we turn to droughts. So first, just 1 second, I want to. Okay, first, droughts are generated by large scale processes. While floods can be very local, think of the recent floods in Italy, very local ones. Even if we focus on the river where the floods occurred, the major impacts are very local. Droughts are more extended in space, and they may have national to international spatial scale, national to international extension. Typically, the most concerning droughts in Europe have a spatial extension that spans over the majority of the European surface. And they are originated by large scale processes. Floods, small floods, are originated by local rainfall. Droughts are originated by large scale processes. And we know that, for instance, El Niño and La Niña are large scale atmospheric processes that are very relevant to droughts. What is, once again, La Niña that you see depicted here? El Niño and La Niña in general are produced by significant differences in temperature between the West Pacific Ocean and the Eastern Pacific Ocean. This difference in temperature means that when we have warm temperature of the ocean in the West and a cooler ocean in the East, we have more evaporation, close to Australia, and less evaporation close to the South America border of the Pacific Ocean, which means that you have a lot of rain and possibly floods close to Australia in the West, and you have drought conditions in the East. And this pattern, which is also related to ocean circulation, we don't go into the details. Let's limit ourselves to the practical effect in terms of rainfall. This pattern may last for several months, and in some cases may also last for years. This is a cyclical phenomenon which occurs, this is La Niña, and the opposite is El Niño, when we have warm at the East and cooler at the West, it's called El Niño. This pattern, which produces opposite effects, El Niño produces droughts in Australia and rainfall in South America. This pattern also produces effects far from Australia and South America. Even the European climate is influenced to a lesser extent, but still influenced by El Niño and La Niña. And these cycles occur with a periodicity that is about from 2 to 7 years. So these are periodic processes which produce relevant effects, especially in terms of droughts, not that much on floods, but in terms of drought, they produce relevant effects, and these processes cannot be predicted. Even if they are periodic, the periodicity is not regular, so we cannot predict them. And it is not clear whether they are impacted by global warming or not. This is still not clear. So this is the mechanism generating droughts. The droughts become particularly concerning if they last for a long time, of course. Because if they last for only one season, only for one summer season, we have ways to compensate. For instance, surface water is depleted soon when the drought starts, but the groundwater, which flows which flows with a limited velocity, it's very slow, doesn't react soon. It reacts after a consistent delay. So if the drought is lasting only for one season, we can compensate by using groundwater. But if the drought lasts for several years, or if we don't have a way to compensate with several alternative water sources, then it becomes a problem. Actually, several multi-year droughts occurred all over the globe. Even recently, I may mention the drought in Australia from 2001 to 2009, the drought in South Africa from 2014 to 2019, the drought in California from 2013 to 2017. So it is a consistent problem, it is a relevant problem. And there is the feeling that the frequency of these events is increasing, but actually, if you look at the data show that these events are cyclical, and we are still unable to reproduce them with climate models. So let me have a look at the next slide, because I think, okay. This is still describing what is El Niño. Okay, so let's now look at the reality of Italy. Italy, if we look, this is a dual graph with respect to the one for the Po River I showed before to you. It's dual because it shows the minimum annual river discharge. And if you look at the overall progress of the minimum, which is an indicator of the dryness of the summers, you see, first of all, that during this time span, there have been periods where the river flow was lower than average. And in particular, look at the time span between 1950 and 1980. It was a long period with the river flow lower than average with respect to what we could see earlier than that and what we could see later than that. But overall, the picture looks like there are no big changes with the exception of the period after 2000. And this exception still is lasting up to today. So after 2000, indeed, we can see in the summer flows of the Po River a consistent decrease. So what is telling us this picture? First of all, it tells us that there is a natural behavior of our climate to suffer from long-term droughts. So we cannot say it cannot happen here. If it happened in the past, from 1940, 1950 to 1980, it may happen again today. There is no reason why it shouldn't happen again. So this is a first consideration. Second consideration, let's try to better understand what happened after 2000. So what is the reason for that? First, if you look at the average flow, you don't see a consistent decrease after 2000. So the first thing that we noticed was indeed that the average was not really decreasing, while the summer flow was looking decreasing. So the first intuition was, if the minimum is decreasing and the average is not, it means that there must be a compensation in other seasons. And in fact, we found that the river flow in the spring season of the Po River is increasing after 2000. What does this mean? It means anticipation of snowmelt. It means that we have this natural storage, which is the snow, the ice. These are natural storages. They are like dams. They are retaining water. But while a dam, we can control the release from the dam artificially, we cannot control, of course, the release from snowmelt and ice melting. With the global warming, this storage is released earlier, is released in April. And the result is that it's not released in July. So here, it's the change in seasonality that is really affecting water resources. to the point that we are now seriously concerned by finding enough water during summer for irrigation. In the region that produces 60% of the gross domestic product of Italy, 60% of our GDP is produced in the polymer basin. Of course, not all of it is related to agriculture, not all of it is related to irrigation, but still, irrigation plays a relevant role. So the message is, let's try to understand what is the cause of the problem. And in this case, it's indeed, climate change is indeed playing a relevant role, but not because it is producing up to now less rainfall, less precipitation, but because global warming, which is a fact, as we said, is changing seasonality. And changes in seasonality imply changes in flood frequency and changes also in drought frequency and intensity. Unfortunately, these changes are not well reproduced by climate models, not yet. So in terms of mitigation, the conclusion is that it doesn't make a big difference. It's global warming the problem, and therefore global warming can be mitigated by reducing emissions. And it doesn't matter really much if the final impact is generated through changes in rainfall or changes in snowmelt. It doesn't really matter much for mitigation. For adaptation, it matters. It matters because there is enough water, so we don't have to look for more water, but we need more storage. This to give you an example. Okay. Now, I think here we don't have anything to say. It's talking about climate models. This is a part of the lecture that overlaps with what you already know. Now, and also this one, we already saw these projections of global warming, which are really, I mean, they are deductive through models, but are extremely important to get to translate this change in temperature, this prediction of changes in temperature into prediction of changes in impact of global warming. Now, let's talk to conclude this lecture. Let's discuss a little bit on mitigation and adaptation to climate change. First, it's a relevant debate. Mitigation and adaptation are two different solutions. Mitigation is acting on the origin, on the roots of climate change. Mitigation aims to reduce climate change, to restore the conditions that were reflecting the state of the system before global warming. Adaptation means that we accept the change and try to adapt to it. Both solutions are important. The best way to act would be an integration of these solutions. On the other hand, you understand that I repeated several times, solutions require resources. We don't have enough resources for applying all the solutions. We need to be very efficient. We need to be cost efficient. We need to save resources. And therefore, the debate on what is the first priority, whether it is mitigation rather than adaptation, is very important, is actual. And even here, we can find a difference of opinions depending on the background of the scientists. Climate scientists, they try to give more priority to mitigation. This is their mission. Engineers or applied scientists, they tend to give more priority to adaptation. It is also for them their mission, because their mission the mission of applied scientists is to solve problems immediately. So an applied scientist usually doesn't accept that the solution comes after 50 years. The solution must be operational soon, now, because people are losing their goods now, are losing their lives now, and therefore, typically, an applied scientist is one who is asked to provide an immediate solution. And therefore, adaptation is acting on a different time scale. It's immediate. Mitigation takes time. There is inertia in the climate system. And therefore, there is this debate, which is, as I said, very actual. So how can we reduce the CO2 concentration in the atmosphere? There are two ways. One is to reduce the emissions, and the other one is to capture the CO2 and subtract it from the atmosphere. The problem is where to store it. The idea is to store it, for instance, in the underground by using depleted oil reservoirs. So by using the same plants that we used to extract the oil, we can use the same plants to inject carbon in the underground. There is some concern that the carbon may leak to the surface through the cracks, because you know, one thing is oil. Oil is liquid, doesn't uplift. The gas is compressed and therefore may leak. And so there is some doubt on the effectiveness. This type of intervention is very costly, is taking a lot of resources. They can be stored, the carbon capture, carbon sequestration may be increased by increasing the so-called carbon sink, which means carbon that is subtracted by the vegetation and subtracted by ecosystems. So this is an effective solution, trying to use ecosystem services to capture more carbon, therefore enhancing the sinks in the carbon cycle. Now, problem here is the time scale and the resources that are required. These changes, of course, need to be organized at the global level, which is also another problem, because global coordination is required. Adaptation is more local, but the impact indeed of climate change is in general, some of them are very local, and therefore adaptation may be in the possibility, may be a possibility also for local administration. Mitigation is not a possibility for local administrations. Now let's look at adaptation then, a couple of slides dedicated to adaptation. And first, let me try to make a summary of what we learned and identify nine so-called fundamental principles to be considered when designing adaptation. First, some of them we already discussed. Other ones we did not yet discuss, so let's have a look. First, the effect of climate change vary by region. We discussed this. And this is something that we have to be aware of. Second, the effects of climate change may vary across demographic groups. We already discussed this. We said that climate change is not equalitarian. The effects are increasing social disparities. Third, climate change poses both risks and opportunities. We discussed this at the beginning of the lecture today, when I said that in the past, warming was associated to prosperity, and cooling was associated to famine and the disasters. Also, if we look at the flood frequency in Europe during the Little Ice Age, was much higher. And of course, we refer in this case to big floods, because the floods that remain in the memory are the big ones. The floods, the small floods in small creeks, there was less population, they didn't remain in our memory. But it is important to keep into account that we have risks and opportunities, and a successful strategy should take advantage from the opportunities. Fourth, the effect of climate change must be considered in the context of multiple stressors and factors. This is the meaning of the lecture today. Multiple stressors and factors, which may be as important to the design of adaptive responses as the sensitivity of the change. What does this mean? It means that these multiple stressors and factors, we need to consider them when we design a solution. And in particular, we have to give priority to them in depending on their sensitivity to change, which means that if you have a society that is sensitive to warming, sensitive means that is strongly impacted, then this is an important information that you have to take into account when designing, when assigning priorities. So you have multiple stressors, take into account the sensitivity of the societal context to these stressors. Adaptation comes at a cost. We discussed this. Mitigation also comes at a cost. Adaptive responses vary in effectiveness, as demonstrated by current efforts to cope with climate variability. So it means that depending on the local context, the success of an adaptation strategy, it's depending on this local context. What is the moral of the story? You may need an integration of solutions, especially if the impact is very significant. You may need to integrate mitigation and adaptation with several adaptation options. The systemic nature of climate impacts complicates the development of adaptation policy. For sure, I mean, the impacts and feedbacks are strictly connected one with another. And therefore, you know, when you design an adaptation option and when you put an adaptation option into practice, you may generate other impacts. Example, if I build a dam for mitigating the impact of seasonality change, I generate other impacts in the distribution of water resources, in the recharge of groundwater, etc. Maladaptation can result in negative effects that may be as serious as the climate-induced effects that we want to avoid. So what is the conclusion here? We should avoid maladaptation because the situation can become even worse. So let's focus on no-regret solution, this important concept you may have heard in the context of sustainability. You may have heard people discussing about no-regret solutions, which means that whatever the future climate will be, what you are now doing cannot be regretted. This is often used with the nature-based solutions, the solutions that rely on ecosystem services. We tend to say this is no regret because even if it's not successful to cope with climate change, in any case, we promote ecosystems, we enhance the functioning of nature, and therefore it's no regret. Actually, it is an utopia because any solution comes at a cost, as we know. So, you know, clearly, a solution may be for some reasons useful, but if it's not useful for coping with climate change, there is a misallocation of funding of resources, which it's not what we want to reach. But in any case, what we want to avoid is the maladaptation in the strict sense. Okay, so what are these opportunities? So in terms of, we discussed how mitigation can be can be done. So let's talk about adaptation. And this first list that I am providing to you is a first list of possible actions. We have to talk about science of climate change and science science of climate actions. So let's look at this first list, the first detailed list of adaptation options. And of course, this is only a partial list, which refers to the most important impacts of climate change. So, let's look at the list. First item, installing protective and/or resilient technologies and materials in properties that are prone to flooding, which means like waterproof buildings. This is adaptation against floods, of course. So we are talking about flooding. And so waterproof buildings you may think of putting the goods with higher value at a higher level. I give you an example. I think maybe I already mentioned this example. In Florence, after the flood of 1966, they got a lot of paintings damaged with relevant impact on cultural heritage. And in particular, there was the Cristo by Cimabue, which is a painting that was, I think it was in, I don't remember the name of the building where it was located, was severely impacted and damaged. When they restored it, they put the painting at a higher elevation in order to make sure that if another flood in Florence occurs, the painting is not reached by water. Actually, they got some criticism because people complained because they wanted to get closer to the holy image, because they were used to get very close in order to pray, and they complained that. But this is a nice example. Another famous painting, The Last Dinner by Botticelli, was placed back in the same position, but over an automatic mechanism, which in case of flood, automatically raises the elevation of the painting. These are examples of relatively easy solutions. These are not very costly. And these are attempts to adapt. Okay? Second possibility, changing to heat tolerant tree varieties, because what we are experiencing is a loss of diversity of ecosystems. And loss of diversity is a problem, and we notice that some trees are more resistant to heat than others, and therefore we can try to shape the ecosystems in a more resilient way. Rainwater storage to deal with flooding, because if you store the rainwater into tanks, private tanks, you reduce the flow to the sewer system, and therefore you avoid flooding originated by sewer flow. At the same time, you store water which can be used for irrigation later on. So rainwater harvesting is widely used, for instance, in Australia after they experienced the long drought from 2001 to 2010, 2009, more or less. They increased the use of rainwater harvesting, and their experience is very positive. There is to say that it is extremely important to maintain them, clean. Their experience was that to keep them fully functional, they need a lot of maintenance, but their experience is positive. And rainwater harvesting is being considered also here. Reducing paved areas to deal with the heat island effect, and to deal with the decrease in groundwater recharge. If we, for instance, you may have seen several parking areas where they remove the asphalt and they put permeable paving in order to use ecosystem services to reduce the flow, the water flow in the sewer systems. In some places we cannot do that because where there is the risk that groundwater gets polluted, we cannot do that. For very high parking areas, we cannot do that. Or for parking areas with a frequent access of trucks transporting oil, for instance, we cannot do that. But in many low-size paved areas and low-size parkings, we can do that. Green roofs. We are several regions in Italy that are promoting the use of green roofs to contrast the warming, the summer warming. They may allow us to avoid air conditioning, and also they can retain water. It is not an easy solution. They require a lot of maintenance. There is an experiment running also at our campus in Via Tracini of a green wall, and the green wall brought a lot of benefit to in terms of air conditioning during summer. Requiring waterfront properties to have higher foundations. Why? Because properties that are at the waterfront of rivers or coastal areas, they may be subjected to erosion if during floods. And if the foundation are superficial, then there is a risk of collapse. We have seen several pictures of entire houses that are floating along rivers because they have been removed from their foundations. Raising pumps at wastewater treatment plants. What does this mean? It means that we can reuse the water from wastewater treatment, especially for irrigation. Surveying local vulnerabilities, raising public awareness, and making climate change specific planning tools like future flood maps. This seems like obvious. It's not so obvious because if you make a map of future floods, you cause a decrease of the value of the houses that are there, and therefore people may oppose to it. This is what happened in Florence, I think. I'm not sure I already mentioned to you this case. In Florence, they tried to issue a flood map and they had to withdraw it after 1 week because people were protesting and questioning the reliability because it had an effect on the value of the houses, which is relevant, I mean. Incentivizing lighter colored roofs to reduce the heat island effect. Installing devices to prevent seawater from backflowing into storm drains, because backflowing means salting. So you see that there is a treatment of several impacts here. There are actions, these are actions that are oriented towards the adaptation to several impacts of climate change. Installing better flood defenses, such as seawalls and increased pumping capacity. Pumping means that if you get flooded, one way of avoiding flooding is to use pumps in order to pump the water away. And indeed, this is a measure that is frequently used for adaptation. Buying out homeowners in flood-prone areas. It is costly, but very effective. We have several houses, and in some cases, public buildings, which we know are exposed to floods, but we don't have any means to remove them because we have to pay the value back, of course. Raising street level to prevent flooding. I think that's it. And this is just a first list. For some of these actions, we will make a more refined discussion. Good. Questions? Yeah, there is a question, please. I repeat.
Is it just a green color?
Yeah. Okay. So the question is, what do we mean by green roof? Is just colored by green or with vegetation? No, the meaning of green roof is roof with vegetation above. And of course, if you want to to keep vegetation over the roof, you have to make sure that there is water, that the roof retains water. This is the purpose. So basically, the roof has to be designed like a tank with walls, and then into this tank you put some soil and you plant vegetation. What is the problem? The problem is that during summer you may have not enough water to keep the vegetation alive, so you need to equip the green roof with some irrigation. And of course this irrigation shouldn't be so significant, because otherwise it requires water resources. So this is one first problem. So in a very dry area, like the south of Italy, you don't see green roofs. And there is a reason. If you go in the Alto Adige region, there are a lot of green roofs. This is one first reason. The second reason is that infiltration is an issue. So in where there is a lot of temperature difference between winter and summer, it's another problem, because the structure of the building may undergo fissuring, I don't know how to say in English, and therefore you have infiltration of water into the building, which is a big problem. And this is a problem, for instance, here in this region. In many cases, the green roofs turned out in problems of infiltration of water, because we have a jump in temperature between winter and summer that is like over a roof. During summer, you may get 50 degrees. And during winter, it's easy to get to minus something. So there is a big thermal excursion, which is sometimes causing problems. Other questions? Okay, that's fine. Let me